Well, thank you, Emma. If you tuned in last week, you'll remember that Emma got baptized here and was added to the assembly. And what you perhaps know or don't know is that she is headed off to Cedarville College next week. So you can keep her in your prayers. And I had the distinct honor of awarding her the pastor's scholarship from Cedarville. So you can feel free to commend her and congratulate her and have her phone blow up again. By the way, did your phone blow up last week? Oh, good. Very good. Well done. So as we give our attention to the study of the Word of God this morning, I want to invite you to take your Bibles together with me and turn to John chapter 12. John chapter 12. We're going to be looking at verses 20 to 50. I can't help but tell you again, there are a plurality of messages waiting to be preached here, and we have done it in the past. In keeping with our commitment to preach through John's Gospel this year, I'm going to try to go through all 31 of these verses this morning at a pretty good run. So I invite you to take your crash helmets and put them on and buckle your seat belts. I'm going to go about Mach 2. Steve will be used to this, but for the rest of you, just get ready because you're in for a ride. There's an awful lot here. The primary point of this morning's message is that Jesus knew the cross was coming. Jesus knew the cross was coming. And it isn't just because he was able to tell the future or predict the way that things were playing out. This was God's plan from the very beginning. I've entitled this morning's message, "The Results of Christ's Public Ministry," because that's really, in a sense, what summarized. There's no easy way to take all of these verses and come up with one clear point. It's really kind of a steamroller effect. But the focus is on the fact that we have come to the end of Christ's public ministry, and he recognizes it because now Gentiles have gained an interest in talking to him. And that is the ultimate indicator to him that the hour has come. The significance of the suffering and the death of Jesus Christ is a primary emphasis in the whole of Scripture, not just the Gospels. In fact, as you look at the Gospels in particular, you can see that the bulk of the gospel message, as it's recorded in the four Gospels, the bulk of each of these gospel records focuses on the last week of Christ's earthly life and ministry. If you were to take a look, we went through Matthew's gospel last year, or in the last few years, and Matthew spends essentially 33% of the verses in the Gospel of Matthew are written containing events pertaining to the last week of Christ's earthly life, from the triumphal entry all the way to the cross and to Resurrection Sunday. A third of Matthew's gospel, of those 28 chapters, a third of that book focuses on that last week of Christ's life and ministry. Mark has, depending on how you handle the last few verses of Mark's gospel, Mark has 37% of his content dedicated to the last week of Jesus' earthly life and ministry. Luke, who's more of an historian, giving more of a chronological account, even going back and beginning the gospel with the announcement of the birth of John the Baptist in the temple there to his father, Luke still has 25% of his gospel dedicated to the last week of Jesus' earthly life and ministry, including the triumphal entry, so-called, all the way up to and through the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. And our gospel in particular focuses on this last week, with 42% of John's gospel dedicated to the events of this last week. And what's really fascinating is most of the material that John records for us does not related to this last week does not appear in any of the other three gospels. When you get into John 13, 14, 15, and 16, and even 17, Most of that material occurs only in John's gospel. If you think about it, from John 12 all the way through John 20 is all about the last week of Jesus' earthly life and ministry, and most of it has to do with the upper room discourse, the arrest, so-called trial, and crucifixion and resurrection. The death of Christ is a major focus of the gospel messages, just based on the amount of content and material that's dedicated to that. Would you agree with that? The death, burial, and resurrection of Christ and the events that happened this last week of his earthly ministry, these are significant. These are the primary focus of our attention in presenting the person and work of Jesus Christ, at least according to the amount of material dedicated in the New Testament to it. In fact, there are 175 direct, at least 175 direct references in the Old Testament to the Messiah's death. So that makes it a focus of the Old Testament as well. And if you move beyond that to the book of Acts and even into the epistles, you'll see that the primary focus of the rest of the New Testament is not on so much the miracles that Jesus did, the sayings that Jesus had, the teachings that he gave, but rather on the fact of the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ. The work of Christ on the cross and what it accomplished is the focus of the Bible. That Jesus came, that he died, and that on the third day he rose again according to the scriptures and ascended back to the right hand of the Father, and that he is coming again to judge the living and the dead. That is the focus of the scriptures. But there is a very, very key, I will say even essential point that we need to learn today that is presented clearly to us here in John 12, verses 20 to 50. And that is that while the death, burial, and resurrection of Jesus Christ is the essential doctrine of the Bible, it is not that it played out that way. That it happened that way. It is that was God's intention from the very beginning. And that's why it happened that way. The cross did not come as a surprise to Jesus. And the cross did not become something that Jesus submitted himself to when it wound up in the middle of Passion Week. There was no other way. The cross was always God's intention. I'm not going to demonstrate this from the pages of Scripture and prove this argument, but I will simply point out that you'll recall in John chapter 1, this is where we started. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God, and the Word became flesh and dwelt among us. And when he appeared, you remember what John said, John the Baptist? He said, "Behold the Lamb of God who takes away the sin of the world." That's at the beginning of Christ's earthly ministry. Before he even starts, before he even begins his public ministry, he is introduced by John the Baptist to his disciples as the Lamb of God who came to offer himself up as the once for all sacrifice for sins. Listen, the significance of the cross of Jesus Christ is clear. But just as clear is the fact that God intended the cross from the very beginning. This is the divine plan for redemptive history. This is the means by which God reconciles sinners to himself. You're going to see in the text that we look at this morning that when Jesus came and died for us, he came and died for us because it was essential for him to die. There is no other way for us to be reconciled to God. I have used this illustration many times. I don't even remember anymore where I first heard it, but I find it so appropriate and such a perfect way, at least for my own little finite mind, to understand it. If God is a righteous, a fair, a trustworthy, a reliable judge, if he is the kind of a sovereign over his creation that makes righteous decisions all the time, then there is no way for him to forgive my sins no matter what I do. He would not be fair. He cannot look to me and say, Bryan, I forgive your sins, but Pete, because of the way that you're managing the internet, forget it. Right? See, that's what happens when you're one of like three people here every week. Okay? So I'm just having fun with Pete. But that's just not fair. It just isn't. Well, but Bryan decided to go ahead and believe in me, and Bryan decided to go ahead and change his life a little bit, and he prays now and ever. So I'm going to forgive him, but Pete, I'm holding him fully accountable for all of his sins. There is no righteousness in that. There is no justice in that. See, I'm not forgiven because I believed. I'm forgiven because Christ died and paid for my sins. And that forgiveness is granted to me because I believed. There is no simple ignoring of my sins. All sins ever committed will be eternally punished. Now, the only question is whether there will be punished on the one who committed the sins, or whether those sins were paid for at the cross. And when you get to the what is ultimately the consummation of Christ's public ministry, when he departs from the scene publicly at the end of John chapter 12, and this is probably, depending on the calendar you use, this is probably Thursday of Passion Week before he goes to celebrate in the upper room with his disciples, starting in John 13 with the washing of the disciples' feet. Or it perhaps is Wednesday. I think Thursday is the better indication, because when we get to the end of this chapter, he's going to separate himself from the public. This is it. This is the end of his time in dealing publicly with the nation of Israel there in the temple and in Jerusalem. And as he separates himself from them, he knows full well what is in store for him, and he knows why. And what we're going to see this morning are the four key results of Christ's public ministry in John chapter 12, verses 20 to 50. And you're going to see that Jesus' earthly ministry was not a failure. It accomplished the divine plan. Jesus came unto his own, and his own received him not. That is not because Christ was inadequate to the task. It is not because Christ in some way failed at his task. It is because, apart from an act of God, none will believe. Apart from the grace of God, none would be saved. And when Jesus came, he came to offer himself to us first as the suffering servant, the one who is the sacrifice who will take away the penalty for our sins. Now, as you look at the four key results, I'm going to go through these in order. What was Jesus's, what were the results of Jesus's public earthly ministry? Number one, when you get to the end of his public ministry, Thursday of Passion Week, after the other Gospels have recorded all of the interactions with not just the multitudes, but most particularly with the religious leaders, as he silenced all of them and they were afraid even to ask him any more questions, you notice there is an initial interest from the Gentiles. So if you're taking notes, this is point one. The first result of Christ's public ministry was an initial interest from the Gentiles. This is actually the bulk of the text, verses 20 through 36. And when these Gentiles begin to seek Jesus out, you see that this is the clear indicator to him that his time has come. Verse 20. Now there were some Greeks among those who were going up to worship at the feast. Let me just remind you briefly the context. This is Passion Week. This is the Passover festival. Jesus spent Saturday evening with Lazarus and Mary and Martha and Simon the leper, who hosted the meal. And she anointed him with that pure nard. And the fragrant aroma filled the house. And Jesus said, she has anointed me for my burial. The next day, Sunday of Passion Week, the first day of the Passover festival, He enters into town and everybody goes, Hosanna, Hosanna, blessed is he who comes in the name of the Lord. The other gospels tell us about him going in and cleansing the temple the next day, just like he did at the beginning of his ministry. This recorded in John 2. It tells us about the interactions that he had with the religious leaders. And then you come to the last day, Thursday, when he's going to celebrate the Passover with his disciples that evening. And there were some Greeks among those who were going up to worship at the festival. And these then came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee. And they began to ask him, saying, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. Now somebody says, well, why do they go to Philip? Why don't they go straight to Jesus? I think this is a pretty easy one. If Jesus is on the temple grounds and he's teaching, if this is anything like the occasions that we have seen in the past, Jesus is most likely in the court of the women there teaching. That's where most of the interaction takes place with the religious leaders, etc. He's in the temple, he's on the temple grounds, and he's teaching in that context. Well, Gentiles can't get that close to Jesus. Gentiles are restricted to the court of the Gentiles. So they can't get to him. That's why they go to one of his disciples and ask to see him. Because in order for them to see him, they have to have him come to them. Most of your commentators will tell you that the reason they went to Philip is because he had a Greek name or something along those lines. I think more likely it's because he was the one most recognized by the Gentiles, probably because of where they're from, because we're told that they came to Philip, who was from Bethsaida of Galilee. So he was recognizable to them because they knew him. They're from Galilee. There were Gentiles in that area, and they're there to worship God. Now, they're not full proselytes. They're God-fearers, but they've seen enough and heard enough of Jesus. I mean, remember that raising Lazarus from the dead was no small miracle. And giving sight to a man born blind, those are the two most recent major signs that John records for us just in the last few months, and Lazarus was just a month ago. These are pretty big things. This is what everybody's talking about, and everybody's wondering whether he's the Messiah. We come now to the end of Passion Week, so he started off this whole festival by cleansing the temple. He's gotten interviewed or challenged in public debates by the religious leaders, first starting with the Sadducees and then the Pharisees and scribes, and pretty soon they all step back and they stop asking him questions because he's beaten them, crushed them every time. Have you not read? Have you not read? So Gentiles are like, well, we would like to talk to you. So they go to Philip, probably because he's the one they recognized as being close to Jesus. And they began to ask him, saying, Sir, we wish to see Jesus. And Philip came and told Andrew. And Andrew and Philip came and told Jesus. Well, why doesn't Philip just go straight to Jesus? Yeah, it's possible that, as the commentaries say, that, well, Jesus has repeatedly been clear. Like when he sent them out two by two, he said, don't go to the Samaritans and don't go to the Gentiles. Go to the house of Israel. Even in the context of Matthew 15, when he dealt with the Syrophoenician woman, he said he was sent to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. So it may be that Philip goes to Andrew because Andrew's a little closer to Jesus. Remember, there's the inner circle of Peter, James, and John. Andrew's not even in that inner circle, but he's Peter's brother. So I'll go to Andrew. The two of us talk, and neither one of us know for sure what to do. So we'll go and ask Jesus now together. So that's what they do. And Jesus answered them. Notice who the them is. The them is not the Gentiles. The them is the disciples. Jesus, from this point, is answering the disciples. That's who he's speaking to, plus all the crowd that's around him that can hear. And what is his response when he hears that Gentiles want to talk to him? The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Notice, he doesn't say crucified. He says glorified. The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. Now is the time. If Gentiles want to see me, that is the ultimate confirmation that the time for me to be glorified, to accomplish the Father's work in such a way as to gain for myself eternal glory in perfectly obeying his commands has come. The time for me to accomplish what the Father has given me is here. And we have briefly pointed this out as we've gone through here, but if you take your Bibles and go with me to John chapter 2 for a moment, you will notice in verse 4, this has been a theme in John's gospel, the hour coming. John chapter 2 and verse 4, at the very beginning of Jesus' ministry, Jesus is there at the wedding of Cana. They run out of wine. His mom comes and tells him that they're out of wine. And Jesus says to her, "Woman, what does that have to do with us? My hour has not yet come. I'm not working on your timetable. I'm not working on my timetable. I'm on the Father's timetable." Likewise, in John 7 and verse 30, when Jesus is teaching there in Jerusalem at the festival, many were the religious leaders, John 7, verse 30, were seeking to seize him, yet no man laid his hand on him because his hour had not yet come. Notice the focus on Jesus being on a divine timetable. Things didn't just happen. Even in the triumphal entry that we looked at last week, Jesus rode in on a colt, the foal of a donkey. Why? To perfectly fulfill prophecy, to perfectly fulfill the Father's plan. In John chapter 8, in verse 20, notice again, these words Jesus spoke in the treasury. That's there in the court of the temple, the court of the women in the temple grounds, which is most likely where Jesus spent most of his time there teaching, either there or in Solomon's porch. And as he taught in the temple, and no one seized him. Why? Because his hour had not yet come. His hour, nobody can touch him. Nobody can lay a hand on him. Why? Because it isn't the Father's time yet. John chapter 12, when Gentiles ask to see him, when Gentiles have an interest in talking to him, learning about him, becoming his disciples, that's the clear indicator to him that the hour has come. You'll see this not only referenced here in verse 23, but then again twice in verse 27. My soul has become troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. Rather, for this purpose, I came to this hour. And then again in John 13, in verse 1, before the feast of the Passover, that is the actual sacrificing of the lamb, Jesus, knowing that his hour had come and that he would depart out of this world to the Father. John chapter 16, in verse 32, he will say again, "Behold, an hour is coming and has already come for you to be scattered, each to his own home, and to leave me alone. And yet I am not alone because the Father is with me." And then in John chapter 17 and verse 1, in the high priestly prayer, the prayer that Jesus prays as they leave the upper room is this. Jesus spoke these things and lifting his eyes to heaven said, "Father, the hour has come. Glorify your Son so that the Son may glorify you." Jesus came to die. John chapter 10. "I have the authority to lay my life down and the authority to take it up again. Nobody takes my life from me." Jesus came to die. And the clear indicator that the hour for him to lay his life down for us had come is that Gentiles are beginning to want to meet him, want to know him, want to follow him. The hour has come for the Son of Man to be glorified. We'll talk about the term Son of Man as we move forward, but again, it's a prophetic identification of himself as human, and tying himself to the one like the Son of Man who receives authority over creation from the Ancient of Days. Daniel 7. Verse 24. "Truly, truly, I say to you," notice the double emphatic amen that he starts with. This is an absolute truth. "I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit." In an agricultural society, in a farming, essentially farming and shepherding community context, like those in the ancient Near Eastern context that Jesus is talking to. You know, there weren't rocket scientists in those days. Those of you that are rocket scientists and fighter pilots and whatever else, in those days, you know what you would have been? A shepherd, a farmer, a merchant, maybe a sailor. Everybody understood the principles of farming. When he says, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. It's you just have that one little kernel. But if it dies, what happens? And you plant a seed in the ground, what happens to that seed? It breaks down and then springs up into a plant. You put one kernel of corn into the ground. It breaks apart, breaks down, grows up into a corn stalk, and then there are a bunch of ears. And what's on every one of those ears? A whole bunch of kernels. They get stuck between your teeth, you know, when you eat corn on the cob. Every one of those kernels. So you go from one to a host. You know what Jesus is saying? It is essential for me to die. If I don't die, my ministry accomplishes zero. Do you realize that? Even if everything, if the Gospels all happened exactly the way they said, but Jesus didn't die, he got to the point where they were ready to reject him, and he said, well, that's fine. Those of you who believe in me, you have a place in my kingdom, and those of you don't, well, then forget you, and I'm just going to heaven. Do you realize we're back to what we talked about in our introduction? The penalty for sin still hasn't been paid. God can't maintain his righteousness and forgive us if Christ doesn't die for us. This is the only way in which we can be reconciled to God. You can't be forgiven because you've done enough good to make up for what's wrong when God's standard is perfect righteousness. Jesus can't just come and do a whole bunch of miracles and take away your sicknesses and restore you from your infirmities and grant sight to eyes that have never been able to see and even raise you from the dead back to a living sinner, destined to yet die again, and then after that comes the judgment. There is no eternal benefit to the incarnation of Jesus Christ, to God coming into this creation and living among us, if he does not die and pay for our sins. The cross of Jesus Christ is essential, and it has always been essential in order for us to be forgiven. Sometimes as believers, I think that we have a tendency, because we are living a more sanctified life than perhaps some of those around us, living a more righteous or upright, moral or humble life than most of those around us, or perhaps than we did last week, last month, last year, or last decade, somehow that we think our sin is not as worthy of eternal condemnation as every other sin. Are there degrees of judgment associated with sin? Sure. Is it worthy of eternal condemnation to murder somebody? Yes. Is that a sin? Yes. Is that worse than just punching somebody? Yes. But punching somebody is also a sin worthy of eternal condemnation. Well, what about just saying something hateful? Also a sin. As bad as murdering them or punching them? No, but every bit as worthy of eternal condemnation. Here's the thing that Jesus taught us in the Sermon on the Mount. You have heard that it has been told that the ancients were told, you shall not commit murder. And I say to you, whoever is angry with his brother, whoever says you good for nothing to his brother, is worthy to go into the fires of hell. Ever had a hateful attitude towards somebody? Ever lost your patience with somebody, just been angry in your heart, didn't even come out? Is that Is that worse than actually murdering them? No. But is it as worthy of eternal condemnation? Yes. See, we are sinners. Even as believers, we are sinners. And our sin deserves to be punished eternally. And if Christ does not die to pay the penalty for all of our sins, then the whole of his earthly ministry, everything he taught us, and all the miracles that he did for us, and all the compassion in the world that he showed to us, is meaningless to us eternally. Jesus came to die because he had to die if we were to have a way to be reconciled to God. And Jesus understood this fully. That's why he said, "Truly, truly, I say to you, unless a grain of wheat falls into the earth and dies, it remains alone. But if it dies, it bears much fruit. And he who loves his life loses it. And he who hates his life in this world will keep it to eternal life. If anyone serves me, he must follow me, and where I am, there my servant will be also. And if ever anyone serves me, the Father will honor him." I came to die. And I came to die because that's what's required for there to be fruit from my earthly ministry. From the whole point of my incarnation, I came to die so that there would be fruit that springs from it. And if you love your life, he who loves his life, if after what I've done and what I've come to do, if you really love your life, if you want to continue to live this life for you, you are welcome to do that. But understand, like almost everybody else, when you get to the end of your days in this realm, you will lose it. And you will ultimately stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, and he will condemn you for all of your sins. And he who hates his life in this world will keep it to life eternal. Now, that's an interesting expression, and it's one of those ones where it's like, how do you make sense of that? If you love this life, you'll lose it. If you hate this life, then you'll keep it to eternal life. It seems like neither one of those is a happy thing, right? Well, notice the contrast. If you love your life, if this life is what matters to you, if this is your end all be all, living this life for yourself, then you can do that. But when you get to the end of your days, you will lose it, and then you will go to judgment. But if instead of loving this life supremely, you hate this life in the sense of you're willing to give up anything in this life to be right with God, you're willing to forsake all to follow Christ, you want a relationship with God more than anything else, even if it costs you this life, then you'll get to keep life forever. If anyone serves me, he must follow me. You want to be my disciple? Remember what Jesus said in Matthew 16? If anybody wants to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and what? Follow me. In fact, let's turn there. I think this text will really open up an understanding of what it says here in John 12. Matthew 16, verse 24. Notice that Jesus is again talking to his disciples, those who are identifying themselves as his followers. Jesus says to his disciples, "If anyone wishes to come after me, he must deny himself, take up his cross, and follow me." Notice again the comparative analogy here where he says in verse 25, "Whoever wishes to save his life will lose it, but whoever loses his life for my sake will find it." See the analogy there? If you want a right relationship with God, if you want eternal life, if you want to be reconciled to God and have a place in the kingdom of God, you know what you have to be willing to do? Give up everything in this life. Now, does that mean I have to sell my house and impoverish my family and leave? No, what it means is that all day, every day, you live for God. No matter what the context is, you live for God. Whether you're a farmer or fighter pilot, whether you're a doctor or first grade teacher, Whether you're an IT guy or a housewife, whether you're a seminary professor or a novelist, your life is characterized by being lived for God, following God, obeying God. Doesn't mean everybody has to be a missionary. Doesn't mean everybody has to be a pastor. Doesn't mean everybody has to sell everything and give everything away. Doesn't mean everybody has to be Barnabas and sell all the property that you have to just meet practical needs in the church. But what it means is, I mean, think about Lazarus and Mary and Martha. They are clearly well-propertied. And what do they do with their property? They use it to host fellowship and honoring Christ and having a place for Jesus to stay during Passion Week. And you follow what I'm saying? He who loves his life, back to John 12, loses it. And he who hates his life in this world will keep it to life eternal. And if anyone serves me, he must follow me. And where I am, there my servant will be also. Meaning you got to be willing, if necessary, even to die for me. And if anyone serves me, the Father will what? Honor him. You want a right relationship with God the Father? There's only one way to have it. That's through the Son. You have to become a follower of the Son because the Son is the one the Father sent to be an authority over us and to be the sacrifice for us. Notice in verse 27, Jesus says, "Now my soul has become troubled." The word troubled literally means shaken, disturbed, unsettled, upset, or agitated. It's a very strong word. Some people have a little bit of concern about this. Why is his soul agitated? This is like the same thing that happened in John 11. Remember there when he's on his way to the tomb of Lazarus? And he's upset at the weeping as those who have no hope over Lazarus? Well, he's got this same sense of agitation here. My soul, the whole of my person is troubled. Why? Why? Because he knows full well what he's facing. My soul has become troubled, and what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour. What hour? The hour of his glorification. The time when he is offered up as the once-for-all sacrifice for sins. And just so we're clear, when most of us think about what is in front of Jesus, we think of it from a simply human perspective. That's not bad. It's just inadequate. When you think of what Jesus is about to face in the next 36 hours, maybe 48, depending on your calendar, okay? Over the next 36 to 48 hours, you know what Jesus is facing? He's facing arrest. He's facing mocking. He's facing slander. He's facing abuse. He's going to be punched in the face. He's going to be spat upon. He's going to get pronounced innocent and then be flogged for it. We're not just talking about a beating or whipping. We're talking about a flogging. It's like a cat of nine tails ripping across your back. Many died from that kind of a punishment. He's going to go through that, and then in humiliation, with a crown of thorns pressed down upon his head, dressed as a king, presented to the nation of Israel as their king in a mocking way, and they're all going to reject him. And then he's going to be hauled out and crucified with people around him, staring at him, mocking him, ridiculing him. And he's going to go through the experience of death by crucifixion. That is just the reason the Romans used crucifixion, they didn't even invent it. They just mastered it because it's such a terrifying form of capital punishment. It's a tremendous dissuader. Jesus knows full well that's exactly where he's headed. And that's not ultimately the fear. That's not ultimately the source of agitation. Do you know what Jesus is going to experience as he hangs on the cross? The one thing that he has never in all of eternity experienced: separation from the Father. Personal separation from the Father. Paul describes it this way He says, God made him who knew no sin to be sin for us, so that we might become the righteousness of God in him. Jesus, the Father turned his back on the Son. That's why Jesus, as he hangs there, says, Father, Father, why have you what? Forsaken me. Jesus, for the one and only time in all of eternity, had the Father turn his back on him, and he treated him as if he had sinned all the sins in the world and poured the fullness of the wrath of God upon him. And then he yielded up his life for us and died in our place. That's what he's facing. I think sometimes we see what Christ in his humanity faced in the cross as just some great heroic athletic or, you know, soldierly kind of a sacrifice. Folks, this goes way beyond that. And he knew full well what was in store for him. This isn't just nobly surrendering himself to physical death. This is humbly submitting himself to endure the wrath of God for us. My soul has become troubled. And what shall I say? Father, save me from this hour? But for this purpose, I came to this hour. This is the whole reason I came. I have to die. I have to offer myself up. That's the only way God's people can be forgiven. That's the only way we can be reconciled to God. Hebrews 12 and verse 2 tells us that we are to fix our eyes on Jesus, who is the author and perfecter of our faith, who for the joy set before him endured the cross, despising the shame, and then sat down at the right hand of the throne of God. When Jesus looked at the cross, it wasn't something he looked forward to. When Jesus went to the cross, it wasn't something that he said, oh goody, I get to be crucified. For the joy set before him of perfectly accomplishing the Father's plan for our salvation, God demonstrated his love toward us, and while we were yet sinners, Christ died for us. You want a good proof that God loves you if you're one of his people? Look at the cross. For this purpose I came to this hour. And you notice what he says in verse 28, Father, glorify your name. Father, glorify your name. It's a perfect submission to the Father's plan, to the Father's will, to the Father's purposes, and to our salvation. Then a voice came out of heaven. Notice the Bible says very clearly it's a voice. And that voice says, I have both glorified it and will glorify it again. Whose voice do you think that is? Well, who did Jesus just pray to? The Father. Well, who do you think is answering? The Father. And what does the Father say? I have both glorified it. In other words, everything that you have done and accomplished up to this point, Son, has perfectly accomplished what I intended. And I will glorify it again. Everything you're going to do from here to and through the cross is going to perfectly accomplish what I intend. The Bible always presents the cross as the preeminent manifestation of God's plan for redemptive history. And it's always been the plan, and it's perfectly accomplished. Notice the reaction to the Father's answer to the Son's prayer. Verse 29, so the crowd of people who stood by and heard it, they were saying that it had thundered. So they heard the voice, but all they could perceive was thunder. It's thunder. It seemed like it was a storm. Can you imagine? Jesus says, Father, glorify your name. And the people were saying, the crowd who stood by, so that's the majority of the people, they're standing by going, wow, Jesus spoke. And then the heavens erupted in thunder. Impressive. Others were saying an angel has spoken to him. Now that's interesting. They are able to discern a voice. But what do they conclude? Must have been an angel. What does Jesus say? This voice has not come for my sake, but for yours. Who is Jesus talking to primarily? Again, we haven't changed context. Who is Jesus primarily responding to in the initial start of this narrative? Philip and Andrew and the disciples, right? And you know what he says to them? And the implication is to the rest of the disciples that are there? This voice has not come for my sake. It's for yours. It's for yours. Some commentators extrapolate this to the voice is intended to be for the benefit of all the people there. Most of the people there only heard thunder. So I'm really convinced the your sake is for the disciples. And for we as disciples today who read and have this testimony. You know what? The Father testified to the Son. Verbally, discernibly, right here, the day before the crucifixion, in response to the Son's prayer, Father, glorify thy name. I have glorified it, and I will glorify it again. The voice has not come for my sake, Jesus said, but for yours. This is for your benefit. So you have now heard the Father personally affirm that what I'm about to go through is what he has always intended. Now judgment is upon this world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. And I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. And he was saying this to indicate the kind of death by which he was to die. Judgment is upon the world. Now you would think that he would say salvation is upon the world, right? Because he's come to die for us. No, this is judgment. This is God is going to pour out his wrath on his Son. And that is going to provide the means by which God can forgive his own and still maintain justice and condemn the wicked one and everyone else who does not come to the Son. I remind you of John chapter 3. Just keep your finger here in John 12. Turn back to John 3. And almost everybody knows John 3:16. Most of the world knows John 3:16 by heart. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whoever believes in him shall not perish but have eternal life. God so loved the world that he gave his Son. The Son came to die for us so we could receive eternal life. We could be forgiven, right? Key explanation happens in verses 17 and 18. Because God did not send the Son into the world to judge the world, but that the world might be saved through him. He who believes in him is not judged. He who does not believe has been judged what? Already. Because he has not believed in the name of the only begotten Son. Here's the key. Until Christ dies on the cross, as redemptive history plays out from Genesis 1 all the way through to essentially John chapter 19, as redemptive history plays out, God doesn't have to do anything to condemn everyone. God doesn't have to lift a finger. God could have wiped Adam and Eve out in the garden. God could have wiped out the wicked one in the garden. God could at any point have done like he did in the cataclysm of Genesis 6 to 8 during the flood. Most people call it Noah's flood. It was really Noah's ark. It was God's flood. And he wipes out everything except those in the ark as a demonstration of global judgment because of sin. Now, when Christ comes and offers himself up as the once for all sacrifice for sins, it brings judgment. It opens the door for now for God to judge and at the same time be able to forgive his own, those who believe in him. That's what the cross accomplishes. God can now act, maintain his integrity of righteousness, Forgive us of our sins and hold those who do not come to Christ fully accountable for theirs and maintain his justice. Apart from the death of Christ, it is not fair for God to forgive some and not everyone. And it is not just for God to forgive and not hold people accountable for their sins. Now judgment is upon the world. Now the ruler of this world will be cast out. He'll no longer have absolute ability to just lead people astray and do whatever he wants. And God can't take action without also eternally condemning his own. The point of the book of Hebrews is when you look at the Old Testament sacrificial system, the shedding of the blood of bulls and goats cannot take away sin. God promised to forgive. That's where the word atonement comes from. You know, that's a fancy theological term that is constructed out of at-one-ment. That's what it means, at-one-ment, atonement. We are at one with, we are in a position where we are at one with God because we have done what he said and trusted that he will provide. But that sacrifice of a lamb in the Old Testament, that sacrifice of a lamb on the altar at the temple, did not pay for sins. It put us at one with God because we were trusting that he would ultimately provide a sacrifice for sin. I'm saying we, like I was there, but I think you know what I'm saying. When Christ died once for all, the reason the veil in the temple is ripped from top to bottom is because now the way is open to God. The sacrifice that Christ made for us has fully reconciled us to God and fully paid the penalty for all of our sins. The ruler of this world will be cast out. I, if I am lifted up from the earth, will draw all men to myself. And he was saying this to indicate the kind of death by which he was to die. If I am lifted up, I'll draw all men to myself. And some people say, well, see, that means he's going to draw everybody to himself and everybody's going to get saved. Or somehow all men doesn't mean all men. Let me ask you, first of all, at the beginning of the context of this narrative, what provoked Jesus to start this discourse to begin with? Who was coming to Jesus? Gentiles. Who has he been ministering to continuously? I mean, granted, in John chapter 4, he went to the Samaritan woman at the well, and he spent a couple of days with the Samaritans there. And as you read in the other Gospels, there were times that he interacted with Gentiles. But now you have Gentiles seeking him out directly. When he says, I, if I am lifted up from the earth, which he was saying, by the way, to indicate the kind of death by which he was to die, he knew it was going to be crucifixion, which incidentally is one other footnote. So Chuck, this doesn't count against my time, but I love the smirk, leave that in. So, and the eye roll too, wow. You learned that one from Gina. So when you look at the idea here, he was indicating, by this he was indicating the kind of death by which he was to die. He was being condemned as a blasphemer. Do you know what the punishment according to scripture is for a blasphemer? What kind of execution it is? Stoning. And he knew full well what he was headed for was what? Crucifixion. That's what he says. I, if I am lifted up, will draw all men to myself. Draw all men in what way? Well, I think the easiest interpretation of this, quite simply, is to say to draw all men, meaning opens it wide open to Jews and Gentiles. But I think there's another aspect here that's worth pointing out, and that is that Jesus has just said, judgment is upon this world. He isn't specifically talking about salvation. He's talking ultimately about judgment, those who escape as well as those who will answer. So when he says, I will draw all men to myself, this isn't the Father drawing. This isn't the John 6, no one can come to me unless the Father draws. This is not that personal draw of someone to salvation. This is Jesus saying, when I am lifted up, The judgment is upon the world now, because once I offer up myself as the once for all sacrifice for sin, the door for judgment is wide open on the world, and I will draw all men to myself, not only Jew and Gentile for salvation, but you remember from John 5, remember what Jesus said? He has the authority not only to grant life, but the authority to judge. Everybody, once I have offered myself up as the once for all sacrifice for sins, the door is open not only for salvation and forgiveness for those who are believers in me, there is also the door open for judgment for all who reject me. Everybody ever born will stand before the Lord Jesus Christ, either as one of his or one to be judged and eternally condemned by him. Verse 34, then the crowd answered, "We have heard out of the law that the Christ is to remain forever. How can you say the Son of Man must be lifted up? Who is the Son of Man?" Now, I don't have time to take you there and fully develop this, but what they're saying is, we've read the scriptures. We know what the Bible says. The Bible for them is the Old Testament at this point. The New Testament hasn't been written yet. We know what the law says. We know what the Bible says. We have heard out of the law. Why do they say it that way? Because everybody didn't have their own copy of the Bible. They heard the law read in the synagogues to them. And what they're saying is, we have heard the law. We've heard the scriptures read to us. And it says that the Christ, the Messiah, is to remain forever. Where would they get that? The Davidic covenant, Isaiah 9. Unto us a child will be born, unto us a son will be given, the government will be upon his shoulders, his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace, and there will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace, on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on forevermore. It's an eternal kingdom. Daniel 7, verse 13, Daniel says, I kept looking into the night visions, and behold, with the clouds of heaven, one like a son of man was coming. And he came up to the Ancient of Days and was presented before him, and to him was given dominion, glory, and a kingdom, so that all the peoples, nations, and men of every language might serve him. His dominion is an everlasting dominion which will not pass away, and his kingdom is one which will not be destroyed. Listen, we've always heard from the scriptures that the Messiah, when he comes, he's an eternal king. He sets up an eternal kingdom. We've always identified the Messiah and the Son of Man together. Who is this Son of Man? You're telling us you're going to die. We thought you were the Messiah. Explain this to us. So Jesus said to them, verse 35, for a little while, the light is among you. Walk while you have the light, so the darkness will not overtake you. He who walks in the darkness does not know where he goes. While you have the light, believe in the light, so that you may become sons of light. For a little while longer, the light is among you. For a very short time, I'm still going to be here. Walk while you have the light. Respond to the revelation that you have been given, so that darkness will not overtake you. He who walks in the darkness doesn't know where he's going. Notice how he doesn't even answer directly their question. You know what he has essentially said? I'm the light. I'm only here for a short time. You know, there's no guarantee you're going to be here tomorrow. There's no guarantee that any of us are going to be here this evening. When God invites you to be reconciled to himself through his Son, Jesus Christ, when Jesus reveals himself to you, you need to respond to it. And there's no guarantee you're going to have longer. These people had no idea that the next time they saw Jesus, the next day, would be hanging on the cross. For a little while longer, the light is among you. Walk. Live in obedience to it. Respond rightly to the light that you have been given while there's time, so the darkness will not overtake you. He who walks in the darkness doesn't know where he's going. While you have the light, believe in the light, so that you may become sons of light. The first response or result of Christ's public ministry is an initial interest from the Gentiles. Second, we see persistent unbelief by the majority. And these last three points are very quick. Middle of verse 36, these things Jesus spoke, and he went away and hid himself from them. And the light departed. Their opportunity to interact with him, their opportunity to respond, their opportunity to meet with him is now gone. Yet though he had performed so many signs before them, they were not believing in him. He had done so many miracles. And remember the best that the religious leaders could do to deny the miracles? Remember the best they could do was come up with, well, he must be doing by the power of Satan. They couldn't deny the miracles. They couldn't. And with all that revelation, with all that supernatural manifestation of the reality of who Jesus really is right there in front of them, they still wouldn't believe. Why? Because they loved this life. They were not willing to forsake all and follow Christ. Though he had performed so many signs before them, yet they were not believing in him. This was to fulfill the word of Isaiah the prophet, who said, Lord, who has believed our report, and to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? You know where that verse comes from? Isaiah 53. This is what God said in Isaiah 53. That's the passage that encapsulates the events of Passion Week and the death, burial, and resurrection of Christ. It's all right there in Isaiah 53. Isaiah 53 begins with this statement. It actually begins the last three verses in the previous chapter, but this is the beginning declaration from God through Isaiah to the nation. Lord, who has believed our report? Who believed the message? And to whom has the arm of the Lord been revealed? Who recognized that this was God at work? For this reason, they could not believe, because Isaiah said again, he has blinded their eyes and hardened their heart so that they would not see with their eyes and perceive with their heart and be converted, and I heal them. God's response to unbelief is not to cater to unbelief. It's not to bend over backwards and give more revelation and try to convince you. If you do not respond to the revelation you're given, he doesn't make it easier for you to believe, he makes it harder for you to believe. That's why he began to speak in parables. And that's what the Old Testament said to begin with was going to be the way it would play out with Jesus, for Jesus when he was here. And these things Isaiah said because he saw his glory and he spoke of him. This second quote, you know where it comes from? Isaiah 6. Remember Isaiah 6, in the year King Uzziah died, I saw the Lord high and lifted up. I saw God himself high and lifted up, and the train of his robe filled the temple. I saw a vision of God personally. And what is John saying about Isaiah? Who did Isaiah see on that throne when he saw God? Jesus, the pre-incarnate Christ, the very one who became flesh and dwelt among us. Isaiah said what he said because he saw the glory of Jesus Christ when he saw the vision of God, and he spoke of him. Christ, before he came, said, this is the way people are going to respond to me. They're not going to believe. And the majority did not believe, and they were persistent in their unbelief. And the third result is intellectual faith by many. Initial interest from the Gentiles, persistent unbelief by the majority, and intellectual faith by the many. Verse 42, nevertheless, many even of the rulers believed in him. And you say, that is great. The rulers refers to the Sanhedrin, the Pharisees, the priests, the scribes, the Sadducees. Many of them, that means a plurality. Not definitely not a majority, but many. We're not talking about one or two, we're talking about several. Yet because of the Pharisees, they were not what? Confessing him. for fear that they would be put out of the synagogue, that they'd be treated just like the man born blind was treated when he confessed his belief in Jesus Christ as the Messiah, because they loved the approval of men rather than the approval of God. You know, this is those who love this life will lose it. Say, but they believed. Belief must mean salvation. You will see a consistent testimony throughout the Gospels that that is not the case. The parable of the soils makes it clear that some believe for a while and then in a time of testing fall away. The Bible makes it clear that some believe to an extent and always hang around but are never fruitful, revealing that they don't actually have a regenerate heart. Only those who believe and produce fruit are truly, truly citizens of the kingdom of heaven. These are some of the rulers, some of the members of the Sanhedrin, who actually intellectually recognize Jesus as Messiah. And they believe, yeah, he really is the Messiah. These miracles are undeniable. He has to be from God. He's got to be the Messiah. Look at all the scripture he's fulfilling, etc. And yet, because of the Pharisees, they were not confessing him. Because they were afraid that if they did, if they came out publicly and identified themselves as followers of Jesus Christ, that they lose their position, that they're thrown out of society, that they lose their position of authority, and they'll lose their position within the community. They love the approval of men rather than the approval of God, and even though they knew the truth, they still weren't saved. I think it's essential to recognize that it's one thing to believe the truth about Jesus Christ, but it's another thing to actually be a believer in Jesus Christ. That's what's so exciting about last week's baptism. This is, again, someone stepping forward in repentance and faith and being publicly identified with Jesus Christ as one of his people. Listen, it's not enough to just mentally agree with the facts about Jesus. You're either committed to him and publicly identified with him, or you are not one of his. And here you have an example of rulers, many of the rulers believed in him. But because of the Pharisees and because of what it would cost them to be identified with Christ and come out of the closet and admit they were followers and believers in Christ, they weren't willing to be publicly identified with him. Well, guess what? Then they aren't really of Christ. The final result is in verses 44 to 50. Eternal accountability for all. Do you know what Christ's earthly ministry ultimately accomplished? Accountability for all. Eternal accountability for all. Verse 44, Jesus cried out and said, "He who believes in me does not believe in me, but in him who sent me." You place your faith and trust in me, it's not just me you're believing in. You are believing, you are banking your eternity on the fact that it is the Father who sent me, and I and the Father are one. That's what you're banking on. He who sees me sees the one who sent me. You want to know what God's like? Look at me. He's going to say the same thing in the upper room to the disciples, right? Well, just show us the Father and that'll be enough. What's Jesus say? If you've seen me, you've seen the Father. You believe in me, then to believe in me means you recognize me as one sent from God, co-equal with God. I have come as light into the world. What does light do when it enters? When you turn the lights on in a room, what happens? You can see. It's revelation. It's enlightenment. I have come as light. I have come to shine light so that you can see. That's why I came into the world, so that everyone who believes in me will not remain in darkness. And if anyone hears my sayings and does not keep them, I do not judge him, because I didn't come to judge the world, but to save the world. That is this time. John 5, he says he's also going to be the one that judges the world. But this time, I didn't come to judge the world. I wouldn't have to come to judge the world. I have to come to provide salvation so that when I do judge the world, I can forgive those who believe in me. I did not come to judge the world, but to save the world. He who rejects me does not receive my sayings. He who rejects me and does not receive my sayings has one who judges him. And what's going to be the standard of judgment for all? The word I spoke is what will judge him at the last day. Because I didn't speak on my own initiative, but the Father himself who sent me has given me a commandment as to what to say and what to speak. And I know that his commandment is eternal life. Therefore, the things I speak just as the Father has told me. And that's what everybody's going to be judged by. I have come not to do my will, but to accomplish the Father's purposes and to offer myself up as the once for all sacrifice for sins. And I have said to you not what I think, but what the Father told me to say. And what you will be judged by is his word that I proclaim to you. And that's what we are all ultimately accountable to respond to the message of Jesus Christ. You know, there are not multiple ways to God. There's one. There are not multiple avenues to spiritual life. There's one. There are not multiple gospels. There are not multiple avenues of access or planes of elevation or means by which you can better yourself. There's one way to be reconciled with God, because we're all sinners, and that's through Jesus Christ. And he himself told us how to be reconciled to God, and that was the message God gave him to declare to us. And that is the basis upon which we will be judged. When you look at the consummation, the completion, or the results of Christ's public ministry, you see very clearly that it's anything but a failure. It accomplished exactly the Father's plan. That included the unbelief and the rejection of the majority, the salvation of the few, and ultimately, accountability for all. Let's pray. Father, thank you so much for sending your Son to die for us. And I just pray today that the result of considering the truths of John 12 provokes us to think about how perfectly and eternally you have loved us, and how worthy of worship you are by us. If there are those that are within the sound of my voice today that believe in you but have not committed themselves to following you, not come to the point where they're truly willing to be publicly identified with you as one of your own, and to step forth in repentance and faith and obedience, then I pray that through your Spirit you would work conviction within them to force them to decide whether they want to be one of yours or stay